for I only knew the first three lines of that first one. And when we got to the fourth one, there it was on the screen. So there it is. As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. That's why we're here this morning. Let's sing this out. I have a shepherd, one I love so well, how he has blessed me, tongue can never tell. Think about these words as we sing them together.
Never tell.
I'm sure for many of us today that the land of Ukraine is much upon our hearts, brothers and sisters in Christ, who don't have the privilege that you and I have today. If there's one thing I would say to them today, it's the words of this hymn we are going to sing. Be still, my soul, the Lord is on thy side. Let's sing it thoughtfully. This will be our last one. Let's just pray together before we sing our opening hymn of praise. Let's pray. Our God and Father, we thank you for the wonderful privilege that is afforded to us today to meet in this church building, to meet with those of like precious faith, and to rejoice together in the goodness and in the mercy and in the grace of our God. We thank you for this new Lord's Day morning, and we appreciate so much the measure of health and strength that enables us to come out to meet together and to worship at your feet. Father, we pray that we might know what it is to worship in the beauty of holiness, that we might know something of your presence with us here just now as we meet together, that what we sing, our Father, will be words that express the desire and the feelings of our hearts. And Father, as we come to your word, that we might come with attentive hearts to listen to what it is that God the Lord might say to each one of us. We thank you for every head bowed in your presence just now, and we ask, O God, that you would bless each one of us with all our individual needs. For those who would love to be with us but cannot today, we commend them to you. We think of those who are sad and sorrowing at the loss of loved ones. We think of those, our Father, getting elderly now, for whom life can often be a struggle. We pray for those who once walked well with God, and yet today perhaps they're not in the place where they ought to be. We pray for each of them, and we pray for each of us. And Father, we pray that this Lord's Day will be a real blessing to us. And if we've come to this place just now carrying burdens and pressures that others know nothing about, Father, may you minister right into our hearts and into our homes so that we might know your blessing, so that we might learn to trust you implicitly. Remember, everywhere else where your word will be preached this day, we think of all the churches in this town who are faithful to the word of God. We thank our Father of those who will handle your word right across this land of ours and further afield, that God would bless them. We pray for Peter this morning up in Kilkeel and ask that you'll bless him there. We pray for Pastor McConnell that soon he'll be free of this COVID and back into his pulpit again. Father, we come to thank you for these days of liberty that we have in our land. And we thank you for it. And even as we do that, we think of other parts of the world today where believers in the Lord Jesus Christ are persecuted for their faith. There are lands today where there will be believers who will not be able to meet as freely as we meet, and yet they love the Lord and they seek to meet together in all kinds of places. Would you bless them and would you protect them? But our hearts, our Father, go out to you today for the people of the Ukraine and those surrounding countries. And you know all about that situation there. And Father, we pray that you would watch over your people and that you would throw a hedge of protection around them, and soon this war will be brought to a close. Father, you know more about it than we could ever do. But we just pray for your people there and ask that God would richly bless them. We think of the women and the children who are being separated from their husbands who have stayed behind. And we pray, Father, that places of safety might be found for them. We thank you already for those in Moldova, those in Poland, those in Romania who have opened up their homes and are bringing in these refugees, albeit they think for a short time. But Father, we thank you for them and we pray that you would bless them and provide for them at this difficult time. We think of missionary agencies who will be seeking to alleviate something of the suffering of these people. We pray for the Joy Foundation. We pray for the work of the Slavic Gospel Association. We think of Faith in Action, and we think of CEF working with boys and girls in these countries. Lord, I'm sure there are many others that we know nothing about, but we pray for these agencies and all other agencies that somehow God can use them in these difficult times to bring the gospel to those who know not Christ and to bring a blessing to all who find themselves thrown upside down by this war. Father, we just commend these things to you this morning. We pray that you'll watch over your people everywhere. And Father, may we take to heart those words we have just been singing, that we might be still. Know that you are God, that there are better days ahead for the child of God, and one day we will be in your presence. Keep that upon our hearts as we pray for others at this time. We offer up our prayers to you in the worthy and precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and sing our opening hymn, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise, In Light Inaccessible, Hid From Our Eyes. Let me bid you all a very warm welcome as we join together this morning. We thank you for coming out to join with us here in the building and those listening in live on Facebook. We pray that God would richly bless them. After the ministry of God's Word, we meet around the Lord's table to remember our Lord Jesus Christ as he has commanded us to do. If you're saved, walking in fellowship with the Lord, please wait while we remember him together. 5:45 tonight, our prayer meeting. 6:30, our gospel service. Pastor Craig will be preaching. Fortunately, he had to go up this morning to Kilkeel because the pastor there was diagnosed with COVID yesterday and he couldn't get someone to stand in at quick notice, so we tried our best to help him out. 8:00, the youth fellowship. Then after our evening meeting tonight, the praise group will be having a practice. Monday night, 8:00 through to 9:00, we're not having our revival prayer meeting this month, but we are meeting to pray for the Ukraine. As I've already said, there are many folks, maybe some of us even know, and they're involved in this particular situation. So we're going to meet tomorrow night, and we're going to be praying for the people, not just in the Ukraine, but in the surrounding areas. I'm sure that there will be things we'll be able to do together for those agencies that I've already prayed about. I'm sure we'll hear more about that in coming days. I've seen many people, you know, over this past week since this has started, putting up on their social media pages, pray for Ukraine. Well, I hope that that's not just something you've put up. I hope that you're praying for the people of the Ukraine. And I hope you'll be along tomorrow night. Plenty of room over in the other room. And we need to be praying about this situation. Tuesday night at 6:45, the Good News Club. 7:30, the Elders Meeting. 8 o'clock, the Ladies Fellowship. The speaker is Valerie Hanna, and she will share about the work of Mission Aviation Fellowship. Now, we know that they use their planes to serve and provide aid to some of the most remote and dangerous countries in the world. So all ladies are very welcome, and the meeting will be held here in the church building. Wednesday, 8 o'clock, Bible study and prayer meeting, continuing with our lessons from the ministry of Elijah, and God willing, I'll be preaching. Thursday night, 7:30, Christianity Explored will continue. We had a good start on Thursday night, so do please remember to pray for that. That's Thursday, 7:30. Friday, 12:15, Woody's Bible Study, continuing life lessons in Chronicles. And then 8 o'clock, the young adults will be meeting in Peter's house. I think they're watching the film, Tortured for Christ. Saturday morning, No Street Cafe next week, 2:30, Torch Fellowship. The speaker is Mr. Henry Middleton, and he will include a presentation of his work with Mission to Mexico. That takes us through to next Lord's Day, 10 o'clock in the morning, Sunday school and Bible class, 10:45, our prayer meeting, 11:30, the morning meeting and the breaking of bread. Pastor Craig will be preaching, and Mark Harland will be speaking to the boys and girls. Then 5:45 is our prayer meeting preceding our baptismal service, 6:30, and God willing, I'll be preaching at that service. 8 o'clock will be the youth fellowship. The nomination papers, please, for the AGM should be returned by tonight. A members' meeting, a short one, will be held after our Bible study and prayer meeting on the Wednesday night to follow to discuss membership applications. All these announcements, apart from one I've just saw now, dear Pastors John and Peter and the Fellowship of Banbridge Baptist Church, we want to thank you all for the love that you have shown us and for your prayers for the time that I have been absent from church. Also, I want to thank all those who phoned Margaret while I was in hospital and those who sent me cards. The operation overall was a success, but I have to go back into hospital to complete the procedure. That's from Hugh Matthias. Please do continue to pray for Hugh. It's good to see him back amongst us again. Now let's take a moment quietly. We're going to pray, and then following that, Alicia Price is going to come and speak with the boys and girls. Let's just pray. Father, we thank you so much that our boys and girls in this land are so richly blessed, not just in Christian homes, but through the various activities of our church here. And as we pray for them today, we do pray for the boys and girls in other parts of the world who don't have that privilege. Bless all the agencies who work with children. May it be that many boys and girls today will hear about the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless Alicia as she comes just now to speak to our boys and girls both here and at home, and grant her the help that she needs in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Alicia.
Good morning, everyone. So today is up. Yes, it is. Today we have a very colourful image on the screen. I'm sure a lot of you know what it is. Does anyone want to shout out what's up on the screen? It's a rainbow. Thank you, Libby. Yes, so we have a rainbow up on the screen. Pop your hand up if you've ever seen a rainbow before. Good, I would say most people have, yeah. So we get to see rainbows everywhere. Rainbows are quite happy, cheery looking. Over COVID, we got to see the rainbows that were used for the NHS. And sometimes we see people using the rainbow on flags and different images. Different people have taken the rainbow and given it their own meaning. We also see rainbows on clothes. You can see the very colourful dress. I'm sure Peter, you or Don, you would love that suit. shoes, everything. We also see rainbows in food. Now, I don't know, this would maybe send the kids all hyper if they ate all of these, but sure. Here is also a picture of myself under a rainbow. That's me. So we see rainbows everywhere. But today I want to talk about, what does the rainbow really mean? Now, I'm sure a lot of you know where the first rainbow was mentioned in the Bible. It was mentioned in Genesis, and it was brought to the people after the flood. So God had created this rainbow, just like he created the universe, the world, the seas, the mountains. God created the rainbow for a purpose. In Genesis 9:14, it says, "Whenever I bring clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember my covenant," that just means promise, "between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood and destroy all life." So that was God's promise to Noah and his family, that he would never completely flood the whole world again. But I want to talk about two more promises that God gave us. And if you think about God's promises, you can think about it like a really heavy chain. If I had a really heavy chain and tried to break it, I wouldn't be able to. And that's what God's promises is like. The second promise I want to talk about is one that I've been thinking about a lot recently. And it's in Romans chapter 10. "For whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." That's God's promise to us, that he will save us from our sins, and that one day when we go, we will go into heaven. But it doesn't stop there. Once we become a Christian, God is there to help us. So the third promise is this one from Proverbs chapter 3, and it says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths." So once we become a Christian, God is there to help us and to lead us. All we have to do is trust in him. Now, recently I had to put a lot of trust in God because I was buying a house and I wanted to make sure I was getting the right one with my fiance. But God, we trusted in God and he gave us the perfect house. So I can tell you that it works. So whenever you see a rainbow, anywhere, whether it's on a picture or a toy or a mask or out and about in school, at home, you can remember that it represents God's love for us. Thanks very much.
She wanted to know what size I was. She said she'd buy me the suit. But I've tried to say, no, don't bother. Gonna stand and sing a lovely hymn, and the boys and girls can leave us during the singing of this hymn. And the hymn's up on the screen, "Standing on the Promises of Christ our King, through eternal ages let his praises ring." So the boys and girls can leave us during the singing of this, and good to be standing on the promises of God. So we'll remain seated while we sing this together.
Standing on the promise, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing. Standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the heart is torn with God, you hear us say, by the living word of God, I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God.
standing on the promises of
Amen. There's no better place to be standing in a troubled world than on the promises of God, and it's good to be reminded of them this morning from Alicia. Now turn with me, please, to the book of Romans, chapter 10, and we're going to read at verse 8 through to verse 21. I'll explain why in a moment or two, lest you think that I'm getting old and I should be preaching this at night instead of the morning, but it will become more clear when I explain to you. Romans chapter 10, and beginning our reading at verse 8. But what saith it? The Lord, the word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the Scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. But I say, have they not heard? Yes, verily, their sound went into all the earth, and their words unto the ends of the earth. But I say, did not Israel know? First Moses saith, I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation I will anger you. But Isaiah is very bold and saith, I was found of them that sought me not. I was made manifest unto them that asked not after me. But to Israel he saith, all day long I have stretched forth my hands unto a disobedient and gainsaying people. Amen. We'll end the reading there. God will bless this reading to all our hearts. If you've been out with us on a Sunday night, you will know that on Sunday nights we have been making our way through a series of studies. I've called them Paul's explanation of the gospel in the book of Romans. As we've made our way through that book, we have come face to face with God, and God has been reminding us of all that is required of us. And of course, we have come face to face with ourselves, and although we may not like it, the Word of God is perfectly clear that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We've come face to face with the gospel, because the gospel places demands upon every single one of us, and if we're ever to be saved from our sin, then you and I know that we do need to believe in the gospel of God's grace. We've come face to face with Christ, for we've been reminded of everything that he has accomplished on behalf of sinners just like you and sinners just like me. And last Sunday night, we were actually reminded of the text that Alicia read out for us today, that great, great text, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." What a message that is. For whosoever, that includes everybody. It excludes nobody. Doesn't matter if you're young, you're old, or you're in between. The gospel of God's grace is real. It's relevant for the heart of every single one of us. It's a message with a great Savior. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord. And throughout this book that we have studied together, there is no doubt that the Apostle Paul has been exhorting us and encouraging us to look away from ourselves, to look away from any structure, a church, a man, or whatever. Look to Christ. Look only to Christ, for he is the only Savior for sinners just like us. And of course, it reminds us that when we do that, we shall be saved. We're going to be saved from the penalty of our sin, saved from the punishment of sin, saved from the power of sin. And one day, God willing, we're going to be saved from the very presence of sin itself. Now, we're coming to the closing study of this particular book, and you might say to me, well, why on earth did you not finish it on a Sunday night? Well, because as I thought about it and prepared it, I believe that God said to my heart, look, this is for Sunday morning. And there's a reason why it's for Sunday morning. We're going to look today at what I'm calling our responsibility towards the gospel. You see, as far as the gospel is concerned, we almost assume that whenever we preach to people and tell them about the love of God and God's mercy and God's grace, we often sit down as believers, those who have already come in saving faith to the Lord Jesus Christ. We come to that place sometimes where we just settle down, we're saved, and that's it. Thank God for the gospel, you cry out. So do I. For if we've never heard it, then we would never, ever have been saved. But you know what? Whenever we get saved, it's not the end of the Christian experience. And that's why I come to these verses this morning, because there's something here for the child of God that we need to understand. And there's something also here for those who have heard the gospel many, many times. And I'm sure there are some sitting here today. Perhaps you've heard the gospel as a child in Sunday school. And you remember those days when you skipped home, maybe with a little present in your pocket, a Bible under your arm, and you stood up before mom and dad and you said, "Will you hear what I learned today?" And then you quote a verse that you learned from the scriptures. And from a child like Timothy, read off in the scriptures, you have known the way of salvation. So there's something today for you as well. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ teaches us so much about life and living. And one of the things that Jesus Christ teaches those who are his by simple faith in his finished work, it's this: to have compassion for the lost. To have a heart of love for those who are living without Christ and in danger of dying without Christ. Whenever you and I read about the Lord Jesus Christ in Scripture, there are many things that would show us that. But you remember how and what occasion it's recorded for us of how that the Lord Jesus Christ looked out at the people and he saw them as sheep with no shepherd. And his heart went out to them, and it says this little phrase, he was moved with compassion toward them. You see, beloved, today, I want you to think about a very important question. And for those of you perhaps who as yet do not know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, I want you to think about a very important statement. First of all, there's a very important question. Look at verse 14 and verse 15 for a moment. Paul says, "How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? How shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? How shall they hear without a preacher, and how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things." Do you note in that little passage that I've read to you just now that there are a number of questions that the Apostle Paul gives to these readers, and they are all interconnected in one way or another? You see, you and I need to remember that in the context of these chapters, Paul still has Israel as a nation on his mind. But what he says about their needs is true of our own world today. Paul simply says that the gospel must be preached, and that those who hear it must respond to that message. They must respond to it personally. They must respond to it urgently. They need to leave their sin and come in repentance and faith to the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you're not saved today, that's what you need to do. You need to make a response to the claims of Christ upon your life. You need to think about that, what you hear from the Word of God, and you need to grasp the opportunity for you to get saved before that opportunity might well be your last. Paul asks here an important question. And in asking this question, he lays at the feet of every child of God a God-given responsibility. Here's what he says. How shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? How shall they believe in him, that is Christ, of whom they have not heard? You see, the question is, how can men and women have salvation if they don't hear the message? How can they have God's salvation if somebody like you and somebody like me doesn't go and tell them? How can they ever be saved if that opportunity is not afforded to them? See, it might well be that Paul has in mind here the preacher. After all, it is the preacher's responsibility, isn't it, to reach the lost. I was brought up like that. Maybe you have too, and that's why you're sitting here and you sit every Sunday night, or maybe you just sit at home. And she say, what does it matter to me about the lost? It's the pastor's responsibility. God called that man to preach the gospel, and he did, or I wouldn't be doing it. But it is not solely the responsibility of the pastor, as you and I will see. I believe this should be understood in a wider context because it lays at the feet of every Christian the responsibility to share the gospel with others. You see, child of God, it's one thing to rejoice in salvation, and so we should. But how can the people all around us know the truth if we don't take it to them? How can people know the truth if we don't bring it to them in a way that is real and relevant? A message that has been life-changing for ourselves and in a way that they can understand. Now, there's no doubt that the world in which we live is changing rapidly. There are so many people today who never darken the door of any church. And we sit and we say, Lord, bring them in. Or sometimes we pray, Lord, if there's anybody in tonight. Should Christians pray that prayer? Should we not be the kind of people that say, Lord, you see the man I brought with me tonight to the gospel meeting? Save him. Speak to him. Do something in his life the way that you have done it in mine. Because the only time some of them might hear the gospel is when we share our faith in Christ with them. The only thing they might ever know of Christ is what they see in our lives as we live with them and as we live before them. And as Christians, we need to grasp again the importance of sharing our faith. We need to take the gospel to those who have never, ever heard. He said to me, Pastor Butcher, we live in a country where they've sent out missionaries for umpteen years. There's a church in every corner of the country, in any town you go to, in any village you go to. There's mission halls here, there, and yonder, and that's the problem. They're full of Christians. They're not full of people who have never heard the gospel. They're full of Christians who sit and listen to a gospel message, who listen to their pastors preach, who go home and say, thank God I'm saved, and people all around them within 20 yards of a church building are dying without Christ. Nobody ever tells them. Do you know, years ago as a young student, I may have told you this before, but it's worth repeating. I had just got saved, and I was in the college, and this wee lady came to me, she's in the glory today, and she said to me, John, there's a wee lady I want you to go to see because you grew up two doors from her and she's hard against the gospel. She listens to nobody, but I think she'd listen to you. I said, you leave it with me. I parted from the church meeting on Sunday, went to college, came back up on Wednesday, and there on Wednesday, or Tuesday it was in those days, I'd come home for the midweek meeting and I thought, well, home early, I'll go and see this wee lady and I'll tell her about Jesus. And I went and I stood at her door and I rapped for a long time and there was no answer. I was just about to turn to go away. And the next door lady came out and by name I knew her. I said, hello, how are you? And she said, how you doing, John? Are you looking something? I said, yes, I'm here to see Mrs. So-and-so. She looked at her watch and she said, John, just about now she'll be buried in the cemetery in Cookstown. For years that troubled me. It still troubles me. What if? What if I had just taken 5 minutes of my time before I headed off for college? What if the people in the church had done that street with tracks and spoke to the people? You see, there are people today and they're lost in hell. The only thing we can say is, what if? What if? Beloved, God's giving us the opportunity today, and I can't stress this enough to your heart and to mine. We need to take the gospel to those who have never heard. You see, you and I are living in a post-church age. You say, what does that mean, Pastor? Very simply this. To a world outside without Christ, the church is no longer relevant. They don't come to church. They're not interested in church. Do you think honestly that a man who's sitting round the corner from here with a 60-inch screen in his wall, who's a Liverpool supporter or supports some other team, and they're on the screen playing football, do you think he's going to leave that screen and come in and sit in church? I doubt it. I wouldn't have. This is a post-church age. There are people here who don't think about church. They don't want to know about church. They don't even understand church. Now, this might rub some of us up the wrong way, but so be it. Do you see from the pulpit or from the door of this church to the man walking past the gate, he wouldn't have a clue what goes on in church. He wouldn't understand our terminology. He wouldn't understand all those great expressions of our faith that we just throw out at each other. They don't know. And Paul says, how will they hear if we don't tell them? How will they know anything about the gospel if you and I don't take the time and make the time to say, look, can I share something with you about my faith? You see, Paul's sharing this from a heart of deep concern, because we know that in Romans 10:1 he says this, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is what? That they might be saved. Is that true of the man or woman next door to you and to me? Paul had a passion for others apart from himself. He had such a concern for them that this man went on 3 missionary journeys. He put his life in danger in every city and town where he went, followed by Judaizers who couldn't understand this man's conversion to Christ. He did it all. Why? To be remembered as a missionary? No, no. Because he loved people. And he loved people because he loved the Lord. And he brought the gospel to them. And I have to say that this has challenged me no end. Ask yourself this question today as a child of God. Are you concerned about the spiritual and moral state of our land? Are you in the least bit interested in the spiritual welfare of others? Are you aware that if we don't share our faith and win people to Christ, that they are actually going to perish? You say, Pastor, it really doesn't bother me. For once I get inside my house, that's the only thing that concerns me. Well, you're most unlike Christ. He saw the people, a sheep without a shepherd. He was moved with compassion for them. And Paul looks at these believers he's writing to and he simply asks this very important question. How then shall they call on him whom they have not believed, and how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? Beloved, this isn't the Amazon anymore. This isn't sending people out to Peru, to Spain, and to all arts and parts of our world. There are people on our doorsteps. They've never heard about Jesus. It's a very important question for the child of God. Here's the second thing. There's a very important statement here for those that don't know Christ yet. Remember what Alicia shared with us, that great statement we thought about last Sunday night. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. See, that encourages us with the gospel. That encourages us. Whosoever, all embracing, young, old, all in between, there's hope through the gospel of God's grace. But you know something? Paul simply puts it like this when he says, but they have not all obeyed the gospel. Even if men and women hear it today from us, and even though we make every effort to reach them, there's no guarantee they will respond to the claims of Christ. That should not deter us from trying to reach them. Now, Paul, speaking of Israel as a nation, quotes from Isaiah's prophecy. It's something they would have known. And he reminds us that not all who hear will receive the good news of the gospel gladly. Israel as a nation were abundantly blessed by God in so many different ways. God, through the prophets, had spoken to them. Still, they wouldn't listen. God gave them one opportunity after another. They even killed some of the prophets that God sent to be a spokesman. And then we see that God sent his son to be their savior, and they didn't recognize him. Imagine praying for a Messiah, a deliverer, and when he comes on to his own, and his own received him not. Didn't know him. And worse than that, they took him. After they rejected him and they nailed him to an old rugged cross. And the one who had come to die for them, they put him to death and they didn't even know why. Do you know what they did? Well, they did lots of things. But they rejected God's offer of mercy. They crucified the one God had sent. They turned their backs upon the only one who could save them. And Paul sums it up well when he says, but they have not all obeyed the gospel. What about you? And I go say this very lovingly. But you know, you could sit in a church like this for 50 years and end up in hell. Not terrible. And you will have heard better preachers than me, far better than some who have been here. You've heard the gospel and you're still not saved. Think of the opportunities wasted. Think of the mercy rejected. Think of the love that you've despised. Think of the Christ that you've turned your back on. But they have not obeyed the gospel. Paul says something here important. And in a threefold way, I'll do it very quickly and ask you to think about it before you go home. He says, firstly, you need to understand the importance of hearing. Now, gentlemen, you know sometimes you'll be accused of selective hearing. Sometimes my wife will have a Hoover going, a washing machine, everything in the same place, and she'll be up the stairs and she'll down at me and she'll say, did you not hear me? And I'd say, how'd I hear ye? Sure, the house is full of stuff that's all on at the one time. I can hardly hear myself. But you know, it's possible to hear and hear nothing at the same time. It's actually possible to sit and listen and not hear. And Paul says, listen, as far as the gospel is concerned, faith comes by hearing. Jesus said to those in his day that he preached to, he that hath ears, let him hear. Do you ever go home from a meeting and say to yourself on the way home or when you get home to your own house, say to yourself, do you know what? God spoke to me this morning. God spoke to me today about my sin. God spoke to me about my soul. What did you do about it? What did you think about? Faith comes by hearing, Paul says, and hearing by the word of God. When you sit and you listen and you hear, do something about it. You know, one occasion, I sat with a man to talk about Jesus, and he was very open. He was also very honest. And of course, in those days, I thought I could turn the world upside down in a fortnight, and I was talking to him firmly. And he put his arm on my shoulder. He said to me, son, I want to tell you, I have heard all the great preachers in this land preach the gospel. And I put my hand in his hand. And I said, yes, and it hasn't made 1 ounce of difference. Because you can hear, but not really hear. And you can hear and you can know and do nothing about it. You need to understand the importance of hearing. You need to understand the importance of faith. Faith comes by hearing. In other words, when you hear the gospel being presented to you simply, whether a child on your mom's knee, whether sitting in a church, whether across the workbench with a colleague who's a Christian, you see, whenever he speaks and he speaks the love of Christ to you through the gospel, you need to respond in faith. This faith is a personal faith. It's a faith that needs to be exercised in Christ. You cannot depend on anyone else's faith. You know, sometimes when you do funerals in homes, you meet people and they'll come up and sit down and they'll say, Pastor, thank you for doing this today. You don't know me. I'm so-and-so and I'm a son and I've been living away for the last 50 years. Do you know what? I remember my mummy praying for me, and I remember going to the church, and I knew as a child I needed to be saved. And I just say, well, are you saved? No, they're not. Because you can hear the gospel umpteen times over umpteen years and never exercise faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and go out into a lost eternity. You need to come to the place today where you will honestly say this. Enough for me that Jesus died. This ends my fear and doubt. A sinful soul, I come to him and he'll never cast me out. I need no other argument. And I seek no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. If you know that personally today, you should be right where you're sitting, lifting your heart to God in prayer and saying, yes, Lord, I do believe, I will believe that Jesus died for me. Hearing is not enough. Knowing the gospel is not enough. Being brought up in a Christian home is not enough. You need to believe what you hear. Paul says, grasp the importance of hearing, understand the importance of faith, and understand the importance of the Word of God. I think that's very relevant for our day. You see, men have their own ideas about salvation. You meet them everywhere. I said to a lady the other day when we were talking and she says, how did you get saved? I said, well, I heard the gospel for years in Sunday school, but how did you get saved? I said, well, five of us used to sit on a bar stool every Friday. And the five of us talked about salvation. On a bar stool. And we debated and discussed it every single week until one got saved, two got saved, three got saved, four got saved, five of us got saved. Why? Because we simply exercised faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Knowing about him means nothing if you won't come as a sinner to Jesus. Would you not do that today? And not reject him again. And not come to that place where you say, I know, and I know, Pastor, and I know, and you're trying your best, and I know. No, you don't know anything about me. My heart bleeds for you. Because the one thing that would do my head in is that someday I might have to come to your house and look into the face of your family and bury you. And all I can remember is the wasted opportunities. The times you could have come, but you wouldn't come. You died without Christ. Surely this is the day to think about this. Paul says faith comes by hearing. We heard it this morning. The Word of God that tells you of one who loves you and died to save you. You've heard it. The question is, will you now come? Come to Jesus. The hymn simply says once again, the gospel message from the Savior you have heard. Will you heed the invitation? Will you turn and seek the Lord? I hope that you will, because your eternal destination depends on it. And I can't make it more simple than that. There's a great question here, child of God, before we leave. How will they hear if we don't tell them? And there's a great statement here: not all who heard believed. Will that be the epitaph that marks your tombstone? I heard it often, and you had inside out. Everybody else in my home was saved, but I didn't believe. Let's just bow our heads quietly and pray together. We're going to sing after I pray, and those who are staying for the table, please do that. Those who don't, wait until we finish the first verse. I'll greet you at the door as you leave this morning. But let's pray. Father, what a challenge your word is to all of us today. There are many, not across the shores, but on our doorstep, who don't yet know Christ. Would you help us to win them while we are still in time and they're not in eternity, for then it's too late. May we be more like Jesus, moved with compassion when we see the loss. For those here today without Jesus as their Savior, maybe listening in at home, they know the way, they know the truth, they know all about Him. May this be the day when they'll exercise faith and come and trust Him as their Savior. For those who leave, we pray that you'll take them safely home. Those of us who wait around the Lord's table, minister, we pray to our hearts. We ask it all in the Savior's precious name. Amen. Amen. Let's sing our closing hymn today. His hands were pierced. This is one we've been trying to learn. His hands were pierced, the hands that made the mountain range and Everglade, that washed the stains of sin away. Thinking about the Savior as we leave this morning. Let's stand and sing.